Good morning. Really? Good morning. Welcome. Let's stand together. Let's open in prayer this morning. Lord Jesus, Lord, you are always welcome in this place, in this house. Lord Jesus, as we come together to honor you, Lord, today taking Holy Communion, God. Lord, we thank you for the price that you paid for each person in this room this morning. Lord, just come and reign over our lives in this house this morning. Just inhabit our praise in Jesus' name.
Lord, I'm far from innocent. The shackles I wear are all on my own. Scarlet sins at a crimson cost.
Finally, hey! Father, Your glory this morning. Moses asked God to show him his glory. And the Lord replied in Exodus 33:19. The Lord said, I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. God equates his glory with his goodness. It's the goodness of God to save mankind from their sins by sending his son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross for us. Jesus, who is the fullness of God's glory, manifested to us. John chapter 1, verse 14 says, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. Glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. If you want to see God's glory, if you want to know God's glory, then you have to know Jesus Christ. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for bringing us into this place. Lord, your kindness, your goodness, and your glory is so overwhelming to us. When Isaiah saw your glory revealed in Jesus Christ on the throne, he repented of his sins. As he heard the angels crying out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, and the whole earth is full of his glory." That is so true for us, especially the believers in Christ Jesus, that the whole earth is full of the glory of God. So, Lord, we ask that you be with us this morning, that you unite us in the love of Christ as we submit our lives to the teaching and the authority found in your holy word. We love you, and we do give you all the glory this morning. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Please remember to keep the missionaries we support in your prayers. This is TJ Heights. He's a missionary with Mission of Hope. This is Jeremiah and April Markley, along with their kids, Jordan, Sarah, Judah, and Elena. They are missionaries with Ethnos 360 in Papua New Guinea.
Good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? Good. Good. Glad to hear it. Glad you're here with us this morning. Love Communion Sunday. I love that obviously every Sunday we gather in the name of our Lord, by the sovereign work of our Lord, building His church. But on these Sundays, we particularly remember our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the work He accomplished on the cross on our behalf. So, I have perhaps the undesirable quality or ability to turn one message into two. So this is a part two. It grew a little bit from last week. So I'm going to pray for myself and for us, and then we'll get started. If you guys would bow with me. Heavenly Father, Lord, Lord, it's so hard to come to you with anything meaningful on my behalf. It's hard to open my mouth and speak of Almighty God. I'm so thankful, Lord, that you have revealed yourself to us in Scripture, that you inspired these men that wrote your word in an infallible way, that we know that these are the words of the living God. You have revealed yourself to us in your word. There's nothing we can add to make it any better. God, you've given us your Holy Spirit to reveal its meaning to us. I pray that as you are faithful, you would be faithful to minister to us this morning your holy word. As we study it, it would transform us into your image. God, that we would be a church that you've built that glorifies you. Lord, we love you this morning. Give us eyes to see, give us ears to hear. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So last week, we started to look at the elements. We're in Acts 15, right on the tail end, and we're going to go through the first 10 verses of chapter 16, and then add a bonus verse at the end. But we're looking at the beginning of Paul's second missionary journey, and he's going right back to the region of Galatia, where he had left some months before. And we started to look at, specifically in this text, the different elements of evangelism that are on display here throughout the beginning of Paul's second missionary journey. And Paul, throughout his life and writings, we know that he was a fierce example of what it looks like to be saved, to have a heart of stone replaced with a heart of flesh. And in response to the Lord saving him, what a life surrendered to Christ looks like. We know from his writings, nearly every letter starts in a similar way. He's constantly calling himself a slave to Christ. And in Romans 1, he begins his letter to the Roman church no differently. He says, Romans 1:1, Paul, a bondservant of Christ Jesus, called as an apostle, set apart for the gospel. He was a slave to Christ, and he was set apart for the preaching of the gospel of his Lord. We know from 1 Corinthians 9:16, his compulsion in life was to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Says, for when I preach the gospel, I cannot boast, since I'm compelled to preach. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. I love that language. It should give us pause. If we are bearers of the gospel of Christ, if it is proven to transform us from death to life, If salvation has been found for us in the preaching of the gospel and by the work of the Holy Spirit, what else can we do but proclaim it to other people, right? We must be compelled to share the gospel of Christ as Paul is. It seems that Paul desired to preach the gospel of Christ to the whole world that they might be saved. If he could, he would evangelize everyone so that they may hear and that they may call on the name of the Lord to be saved. That's what evangelism is. When we use the word evangelize or evangelism, it is the term we use to refer to preaching the gospel. Paul sums it up beautifully, as he often does in Romans 10, 13 through 15. For whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. So who can be saved? Whoever calls on the name of the Lord, verse 14, this illustrates the Lord choosing the preaching of the gospel to build his church. He says, how then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? How will they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how will they hear without a preacher? So they can't call on him whom they haven't heard about. And they can't hear about him unless someone is sent to tell them. And if no one is sent to tell them, they can't believe in what they haven't heard and whom they haven't heard about. They need a preacher, someone to evangelize them. Verse 15, how will they preach unless they are sent? And then he quotes from Isaiah, just as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news of good things. Someone has to be sent. So who is sent then? We've heard this a few times. We know it well, but according to Matthew 28, we're all sent, right? The Lord sends the disciples. He says, go and make disciples, right? Teaching them to obey all that I've commanded you, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. It's the church's mission, as defined by our Lord, to go and preach the gospel. In all of Christianity, all of evangelical Christianity agrees and champions the necessity of evangelism. However, there is not the same consensus as to the methods of evangelism. There are many different approaches to evangelism, ranging from sitting down with someone, opening the scriptures, to a stadium production with bands, multiple speakers. We see large crusades on every continent, and it's not that those things are bad or one is better than the other, but in either instance, Scripture tells us that the results are up to the Lord. But what we see in our text this morning by observing Paul are the essential foundational principles undergirding all truly biblical evangelism. The first principle we saw starting in verse 36 last week was Paul had the right passion. 15:36, after some days, Paul said to Barnabas, let us return. He says, let us return. As we saw from his letter to the Corinthian church, he was compelled to preach the gospel. And we just read that he wrote what he wrote to the Roman church. If no one tells them about Christ, they can't believe in him. And I love how he phrases this to the Roman church as well, Romans 1, 15 and 16. So for my part, he says, I am eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome. This is my part. This is what I do. I preach the gospel. I'm compelled by the gospel of Christ. And that's what we do. We preach the gospel. That's our part. The rest is up to the Lord. Why does he preach the gospel? Verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. The gospel, church, is no less than the power of God unto salvation. Paul's passion, what motivates him to continue towards the next person, onto the next town, in the face of the next trial, is the gospel of Jesus Christ and its saving result in all who believe. So this must be the basic foundational passion for every believer. And I would just ask this morning, does the gospel of Jesus Christ compel you? We're going to take communion this morning. What does that mean to you? What does the work of the cross mean to you? Do you understand that you were dead in your sins and trespasses? And the Lord Jesus didn't just help you, he saved you. He made you alive in himself. What does the gospel mean to you? Does it burn in you to go tell others? Does it compel you, as Paul writes to the Philippian church, to conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ? Why do we live a certain way? Why do we live a restrained life? Because of what Christ did for us. 1 John 4:19, we love him. Why? Because he first loved us. We're constrained by the love of God in Christ towards us. And I think the more we dwell on that, the more we understand our condition and the work of the cross, we're honored to love him in return. And we become overwhelmed that he accepts our love. Christ was Paul's passion, and he must be ours as well. And Paul had the right passion. Right? Then we saw in the same verse that he had the right priority. He says, let us go, and then he goes on, the rest of 36, and visit the brethren in every city in which we proclaim the word of the Lord, and let's see how they are. Paul loved everyone who came to Christ under his preaching as if they were his own children. He wanted to rock. Paul wanted to rock with everyone that had come to Christ under his ministry. I want to rock as well with you all. Only at Revolution Church. This is like a living room. We get the family atmosphere. If you were in a big congregation this morning, only like four or five people would have known what was happening over there. I don't know what was happening. Listen, the devil does not like this message. That's the old standby. That's demonic oppression. We're going to power through. Right? Pray for them. Sin in that area of the camp. It's going to turn into a deliverance this morning. I'm just kidding. Completely off the rails. Evangelism. We're talking about evangelism and Paul's example. He wants to go visit his spiritual children, his brethren, the new converts to the faith, and he wants to go see how they are because he loved them. No different than you wanting to go visit your children. You want to be with them all the time. When you get to go see them, it's very exciting. Paul loved everyone who came to Christ under his preaching as if they were his own children. He missed his brethren. He missed his spiritual children. When he was away from them, he wanted to be with them. And this is clear in all of his writings. He longed to be with all of them wherever they were. He appeals to the authority of God when he tells the Philippian church how much he misses them. Philippians 1:8, for God is my witness how I long for you all with the affection of Christ Jesus. In other words, Paul was responsible for them as a loving father in the faith. He wanted to see them grow into mature believers. No different than I'm responsible for my children. I want to raise them up, right? I want to see them grow into mature followers of Christ. In modern evangelism, or the conference-type evangelism that we see today, it seems that element is missing, even in discipleship. Too many men don't feel responsible for what they say and how it may affect someone who is genuinely seeking the Lord. And because they have such a large platform, what comes with that platform is perceived credibility. So it gives more weight to what they say. And someone in the crowd seeking the Lord may take what they say that might be incorrect, that might be unbiblical, and they may think, I need to do that, and it may cause them harm. Paul's passion was the gospel of Christ, and his priority was preaching it to train up mature believers. And he was accountable to the words that he said. He was accountable to the word of God. The third element that we saw last week, Paul had the right passion, he had the right priority, and this one was sort of something we may not think about, but he had the right personnel, and this one I love, and I'm not sure I would have if I was there, because it's not a situation that we would desire to be in, but as I said last week, this is, I think one of the great values of Scripture is that all of this for us is hindsight, right? We can see perfectly what the Lord did because we see what has happened, and that's the case here. This is not something that we would orchestrate. Oftentimes, the Lord orchestrates things in a way that we would never do it because we don't know what he's going to do. And if he hadn't done it the way he did it, the outcome wouldn't have been the same. We look back and we can see that, thank God he caused things to happen this way because this is what he intended to do and this is where we are. And that's certainly the case here, Acts 50, or 15, 37 through 40. Or if you remember, Barnabas wanted to take John or Mark along with them, but Paul kept insisting that they should not take him along, who had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not gone with them to the work. The first missionary journey they took, Mark left. Verse 39, and there occurred such a sharp disagreement here between Paul and Barnabas that they separated from one another, and Barnabas took Mark with him and sailed away to Cyprus. But Paul chose Silas and left, being committed by the brethren to the grace of the Lord. So Paul and Barnabas went on this really epic missionary journey. They're first to the Gentile world beyond Antioch. And they were really forged together, must have been, through the trials of this journey. They certainly knew what each other was thinking. They certainly had become accustomed to ministering with one another, encouraging each other, going through really hard things together, and also experiencing really amazing supernatural moves of the Lord. Many, many thousands came to Christ. Churches were popping up in the region of Galatia. They come back. They go to the Council of Jerusalem. They have another sort of victory in the gospel of Christ. They settle the doctrine of salvation. They come back to Antioch. They're proclaiming what the council had said, reiterating the gospel. Now they've got this letter from the council stating, you know, the liberty that the Gentiles have in Christ, don't exploit it in front of your Jewish brethren so they won't stumble. They're compelled now to take this back to the region of Galatia, and they split. And it must be, obviously, that the Lord orchestrated this necessary circumstance for these two dear brothers in Christ to go their separate ways. The Lord took one missionary team, splits it into two teams. It's clear, we know again from hindsight, the reading of Scripture later, that Mark needed Barnabas and they needed to go back home. Barnabas was a gentleman, a sweet man, certainly a gentle teacher, and that's what Mark needed. We know later that Paul loved Barnabas, and Paul writes to Timothy later concerning Mark. He says, have him meet me here. Have him come to me. He could be profitable to me. So Paul loves Mark as well. But these dear brothers split. Now what the enemy wanted to do in shutting down one missions team has created two, and the gospel goes now in two different directions. So they're going now into Roman territory, and Paul, again, there was a different personnel was needed for this journey. Paul needs Silas for this one. Silas wouldn't have joined them if the Judaizers hadn't come down to Antioch, disrupted the brethren, caused the men to go to the Jerusalem council. Silas joined them from there, and now he finds himself back in Antioch with Paul, and now they're going on this journey together. And because Paul and Barnabas parted ways, Barnabas goes to Cyprus, if you remember that. The first journey, they went there first. Paul's going to make the second rounds again, but since Barnabas goes to Cyprus, Paul goes the opposite direction. What is significant about that? They go to Lystra and they pick up Timothy. Paul wouldn't have picked up Timothy till the end of the journey if they had gone the same way they went before. And this is another disciple who is perfectly suited for this particular missions trip. We know that Timothy was both descendant of a Jewish mother and a Greek father. We saw in Acts 15:41 through 16:3, his lineage there. Let me read it to us. 15:41, and he was traveling through Syria and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. Paul came to Derbe and to Lystra, and a disciple was there named Timothy, the son of a Jewish woman who was a believer, but his father was a Greek. And he was well spoken of by the brethren who were in Lystra and Iconium. Paul wanted this man to go with him, and he took him and circumcised him because of the Jews who were in those parts, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. That gets us sort of to the next thing concerning biblical, the next characteristic that there in verse 3, chapter 16, verse 3, Paul's mindful of the people he's going to be preaching to, the people they're taking the gospel to. Although he is the missionary to the Gentile world, if you remember, everywhere he goes to the Jewish synagogue first. The gospel is for the Jew first, because they had a biblical background. They understood Scripture. So he goes, he converts as many as the Lord will give to them there who will call on his name, and then that church now ministers to the Gentiles because they have no understanding of Scripture. So Paul is always going to the synagogues first. Timothy has a Greek father, so that could be a stumbling block to the Jews he wants to minister to. Paul has him circumcised for that reason. He took the right precaution to reach those he was going to preach to. Paul removed any stumbling block, any offense that may be in place that would shut the ears of those he wanted to hear the gospel. And we looked at it last week, but it's worth another look this morning just because this is the mind of the Christian to all that they might encounter. This is the posture of the believer, the humility of the believer in preaching the gospel. 1 Corinthians 9:19 through 22, For though I am free from all men, the gospel of Christ makes us free, right? We have liberty in Christ. He says, I made myself a slave to all so that I may win more. To the Jews I became as a Jew so that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, though not being myself under the law, so that I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without law, as without law, though not being with the law of God, but under the law of Christ, so that I might win those who are without law. To the weak I became weak, that I might win the weak. This is the key of this statement. I have become all things to all men, so that I may by all means save some. I become all things to all men, so that I may by all means save some. What a beautiful verse. What perfect instruction for us as ministers of the gospel of Christ. Paul is a Christian first. We would do well to consider what that means. I respond as if I'm responding in a way that will glorify Christ to whatever comes before us. I'm not an American first. I'm not a whatever else first. I am a Christian first. By the blood of Christ, I'm a citizen of heaven, right? I'm a slave to Christ, as Paul says. Paul's a Christian first. And he's compelled to preach the gospel unto making more Christians. Paul didn't care to be validated. He didn't care to be seen a particular way. He required no platform or title. It is evident in the life of Paul, all the writings of Paul, that his life is not his own, that this earth had no appeal to him, and that his ego had been crucified with Christ. All he desired to do was clearly proclaim to all that he could that Christ was the Messiah. And he's saying here, go to whatever lengths necessary. Humble yourself to the point that you are not your identity, but Christ is the only thing seen by people who you encounter, that you may win them to him. And that, I think that's, obviously, it's powerful. Love who you're talking to. Love who you're talking to about Christ. Take the right precautions. They're not your enemy. They're a lost soul as you were, and by the grace of God, he called you to himself. And we hope and we pray that whoever we encounter, the Lord is calling to himself. And when we go to them humbly proclaiming the gospel, that might be what leads them to Christ. If you don't love the person you're going to talk to or are talking to concerning the gospel of Christ, you probably shouldn't talk to them. So Paul had the right passion. He had the right priority. He had the right personnel. He took the right precautions. And the fifth thing we see here from Paul is the right presentation. Acts 16:4 and 5. Now while they were passing through the cities, they were delivering the decrees which had been decided upon by the apostles and the elders who were in Jerusalem for them to observe. So the churches were being strengthened in the faith and were increasing in number daily. And this is what separates Christianity from every other pagan religion, the key to effective biblical evangelism is the right message. We have the right message. Paul tells us in Romans 10:17, we've heard this verse often in this church, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. So we just looked at what he wrote to the Corinthian church. How will they go? How will they come to Christ if a preacher is not sent to proclaim the gospel? It is the gospel of Christ and the preaching of it that the Lord has chosen to build his church. Salvation comes by hearing a message concerning Christ. The gospel, that gospel that we talk about, the grace of God in Christ alone, that's been confirmed at the Jerusalem Council. And they go now to proclaim it again, back to where they're going back to the region of Galatia to proclaim that again. And they're also sharing what the council had decided regarding the freedom, again, that the Gentiles had in Christ, outlining certain pagan practices that they shouldn't do, not because they can't do it, but because it causes their Jewish brethren to stumble. Some of it they can't do, but the Jews have a particular aversion to some of these things, and they're counseling them not to do it so they don't cause their Jewish brethren to stumble. So this time through, this message is twofold. They confirm the gospel that they'd already delivered, but they also encourage each other to live by love for one another. The law of Christ. Pastor Jason preached on that a few weeks ago. Such a beautiful illumination of Scripture, what the love of Christ is, what the law of Christ is, giving yourself for the weaker brother, girding up each other in faith, not hindering each other by flaunting your liberties, but loving each other and coming alongside the weaker brother according to their convictions, right? So we're all helping each other glorify the Lord on this side of heaven and finish the race faithfully, as Paul encourages us to do. And the healthy effect of sound biblical evangelism and discipleship is seen in verse 5. So the churches were being strengthened in the faith and were increasing in number daily. When the gospel is proclaimed and Christians are loving each other by Christ's example, what inevitably happens? The church grows. So the right passion, the right priority, the right personnel, the right precautions, the right presentation, and something that may seem obvious, but it is interesting how Paul arrives where he does. He was in the right place. Acts 16, verses 6 through 10, they passed through the Phrygian and Galatian region, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. That's strange. And after they came to Mysia, they were trying to go into Bithynia, and the Spirit of Jesus did not permit them. And passing by Mysia, they came down to Troas. A vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia was standing and appealing to him and saying, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." When he had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go into Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. So the Spirit forbids them to speak a word in Asia. It doesn't say anything more on that. I wish that it did. I'm not sure what that looked like. The only thing I would say to that is we have to know and understand that the Spirit of God is perfectly capable of directing us according to His will. It is not a mystery. It is clearly not a mystery here. They're forbidden to speak the gospel in this direction, and then we find out they're forbidden to speak it in that direction. All the Holy Spirit has said up to this point is no or stop. He doesn't tell them where to go, but they just keep going. Then He gives them a vision. Paul sees a Macedonian man asking him to come and help. So what does he do? Immediately they go. And to me, this is such a practical, helpful illustration of the basic principle of knowing God's will. We go. We move ahead. He opens the doors He will open, and He closes the doors He will close. But we are faithful to go. We're obedient to the Word. We preach the gospel to whoever's standing in front of us. If the Lord doesn't will it, it won't happen. If He does, it will. The will of God, as we've said before, is the Word of God. We read Scripture, we obey Scripture, we are Christians, and we continue on that road, and the Lord directs our path. We serve faithfully, He directs faithfully. So Paul, now having clear direction, he does not hesitate. Verse 10, immediately, we sought to go to Macedonia. And that's the first time, maybe you've noticed, maybe you haven't, that we've seen the word we thus far. We know that Paul didn't write Acts. Who wrote Acts? This is our interactive time of the service. Who wrote Acts? Oh, Lord. 16 chapters in, folks. Luke is the author of Acts. I believe the book begins that way. Luke writes Acts, and here we see Luke has joined this group. Luke is now with them, and they're all together going to the right place. And that's what they do. The Lord directs them, they go. And what is significant about the Lord closing the doors to the areas he just had is that the gospel is now going to a new continent. The gospel of Christ will now enter Europe for the first time. And the first church on this continent, I can't wait to look at this next week, will be established by a handful of women in Philippi. The Philippian church is going to be born. They're going to go over there, and Paul will wait for the Sabbath to go preach the gospel to the Jewish community, and there is no men there. It is God-fearing women. If the worship team wants to come back up. So these men had the right passion. They had the right priority. They've got the right personnel. They took the right precautions. They gave the right presentation. And here they are led to the right place. And with communion in mind, remembering what the Lord has accomplished for us on the cross, I want to jump ahead to show us, if I could add one more R word, the result of evangelism the right way. I am so excited to get into this. Acts 16:14 says, a woman named Lydia from the city of Thyatira, a seller of purple fabrics, a worshiper of God, was listening. This I love. And the Lord opened her heart to respond to the things spoken by Paul. So what did Paul say earlier? I become all things to all men so that I might by all means save some. This is what I am so thankful for. All I am supposed to do. Remember what Paul said? This is my part. I preach the gospel. We proclaim the gospel. We don't know who's going to come to the Lord. Our evangelism of the world, the results are not up to us. The results are up to the Lord, right? He's known us all from eternity past. We go preach because we don't know who he's known and who he hasn't known. We go preach, and those he draws come. So we shouldn't get discouraged when our evangelism doesn't always bear immediate fruit. Because it is the Lord who builds his church. What does Paul say in 1 Corinthians 3:6? He says, I planted, Apollos watered, but God was causing the growth. We're just men. I preached, Apollos came behind, he discipled, but it's the Lord who causes growth. It's God who gives the increase. We just clearly present the gospel as we've seen Paul do in this passage. And when the Lord has opened a heart to respond, it will. It will come. I love that with Lydia. And the Lord opened her heart to respond to the things spoken by Paul. So the Lord splits two missionaries to create two missionary teams, sent them into two different directions so that Timothy would join them. Doors are closed in every direction, and then one opens, and it requires a boat. They immediately have a boat. Luke is picked up as the gospel is on its way to another continent. So that this woman, a God-fearer who has not heard the gospel of Christ, can hear it and be saved. And what happens next, like everything else that we've read, is incredible. And that's what we're going to get into next week. But we're going to prepare ourselves to take communion this morning. Most of you have, but if you don't know how we do that, just find yourselves in one of these aisles, come forward and receive the elements, and we will take it together shortly.
In the darkness we were waiting with our
prophet Isaiah came before the Lord and said, "Woe to me, I am a man of unclean lips." We come to the Lord's table, we come just like that, a man or woman of unclean lips. And we find that all are welcome to come to the Lord in salvation, but not everyone is welcome at the table. There's a reservation. I drove by a sign the other day that read, "Everyone is invited to the Lord's table," but the more I thought about that this week, I don't believe that that's true. Everyone's not invited to the Lord's table. That saying, it may promote a spirit of unity, perhaps within that local community, but I don't see where it is that everyone is invited to partake in this communion. It's only those who have a reservation. It's only those who have been found to be in Christ. You see, everyone is welcome to the Lord, to come to Him. And then when they do, they are invited to fellowship at the Lord's table. So those who have been invited to the table of the Lord are those who are in fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And so this morning, if you are in fellowship with the Lord, then we offer this invitation to you to partake in communion with us. If you are in fellowship with the Lord. How do you know? How do you know that you have been invited to the Lord's table? You look to His Word. In Romans chapter 10, Paul writes that the Word is near you. It is in your mouth and it is in your heart. It is the Word of faith that we are proclaiming. That if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, then you will be saved. For it is with the heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. And as the Scripture says, anyone who trusts in Him will never be put to shame. In verse 13, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That's how you know you are in fellowship with Jesus Christ and are invited this morning to partake of the Lord's Supper. If that is you and you profess faith in Christ, then as we remember the Lord's body, which was offered as a sacrifice to us, I invite you to take the bread this morning. In remembrance of the Lord's blood that was shed on a cross as a final and perfect atonement for our sins, I invite you to drink the cup. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for the wonderful gift of salvation that you have given us through faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. I ask that you be with the people here this morning as they leave this place, that you go with them into their homes, into their workplaces, into their environments that they find themselves this week, and you bless them immensely, God. Give me them the faith and the courage to speak the Word of God boldly, to proclaim the love of Jesus Christ to those who may not know you. We thank you for these things. We give this day to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's worship the Lord one last time before we leave.
In the out of the desert, turn my bitter into sweet, all my burdens beneath.
sing this together. You are my, and you are my deliverer, the freedom I'm living in. You are my deliverer, you are my promised land. You are my deliverer, the freedom I'm living in. You are my deliverer, you are my promised land. So let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Sing of his promises.